Welcome, everybody. Here we are in another part of the Nashville battlefield. Apparently, none of it's preserved, and somehow it is, mainly thanks to our friends at the Nashville Battlefield Preservation, or Battle of Nashville Preservation Society. You can see it's not much here that we've got. You know, we've got about an acre over here, and you can see that that acre continues over here at a place called Redoubt 1. Do you see the works behind me here? You can see they put some cannons here. They do a nice job with it. So there are things to see and ways to interpret the Battle of Nashville. Specifically, we're going to be talking here about the first day of the battle. That's December 15th, 1864. The year's coming to an end. We've already had, as we mentioned, some of the terrible weather. Thomas is ready to move, and he is going to hit like a hammer on the 15th. This is a pretty long Confederate line, as we've already described to you, and the Union is going to launch a terrible and a desperate attack here. And I think he's still pushing buttons, but I'm hoping that Chris White is going to come out from behind the camera. Oh, he's getting all the stuff off of the assets there. And then he's going to maybe set up the Battle of Nashville on the 15th of December, 1864. It looks like I need to keep talking briefly here before Chris Witkowski grabs the camera from Emerging Civil War. Chris?
A lot of pressure back there, man. Thanks, Gary. Yeah, so we're standing at Redoubt Number 1. We're along the Confederate defensive line here at Nashville. You know, to give you an idea, to orient you to where we are, basically the Confederate line is going to be facing towards the north. It's going to be facing towards the city of Nashville. We're in the suburbs today. These would not have been the suburbs in 1864. But Nashville itself, the city, the state capital of Tennessee, is off in that direction. To the south, behind the camera, about 18 miles from where we're standing, is Franklin, Tennessee. That is where the battle took place on November 30th, 1864, the famous battle. Check out all those videos with Eric Jacobson and all of our friends down there at Franklin. So what now happens is John Schofield and his army, his 23rd Army Corps and what hodgepodge men he has are going to start falling back here towards Nashville, where he's going to meet up with George Henry Thomas. Thomas is receiving reinforcements from a variety of different places, including gunboats that will be on the Cumberland River. He is going to receive United States colored troops that will be on his left flank under James Steadman, or Steedman, I should say. And then we're going to have a hodgepodge of units of the old Army of the Tennessee. I mean, it's going to be a hodgepodge group up here of approximately 60,000 Union soldiers. So this is going to be a formidable force. After the Battle of Franklin, John Bell Hood, the Confederate commander, is going to move up from Franklin and towards Nashville. Here he is going to threaten Nashville. His idea here is to really try to defeat the Union Army by allowing them to attack him on a defensive line. He just attacked at Franklin. Now it's his turn, he thinks, to go on a defensive, and that's what he's going to do. He's going to establish a defensive line here in early December, which will be incomplete by the time of the Battle of Nashville, December 15th and 16th, 1864. Now, with this all taking place, there's a lot of moving parts. Ulysses S. Grant, the commander-in-chief of all Union armies, is going to be sending word to George Henry Thomas, West Point class of 1840, the Rock of Chickamauga, the Virginia native who stuck with the Union. You know George Thomas, and Thomas is given overall command of this area, and Thomas is told, attack, destroy this force of Confederates. Well, there's a problem. There's this lady called Mother Nature, and she's really angry right now. She's throwing ice storms and snowstorms out into this area, which turns the vicinity into a quagmire, and he cannot move forward. So the next thing we're going to see is another general being sent out here, Black Jack Logan. Grant says, if Thomas can't get the job done, I'll replace him. But Thomas, all he needed was some time. He got everything into place, and this will fall right into his hands. The Confederate line will be established here on this military crest. We're standing inside of what we call Redoubt 1. You would have 2 and 3 near us. You'd have 4 and 5 out front. Gary's going to get into that in just a minute. But this is essentially a hinge point in the Confederate line that would run like a jackknife almost from this point. If you're thinking about a knife closing, thinking about on a 45-degree angle. We have one line running off to my right, one starting to arc back around to my left. This would be held by William Wing Loring's division, or at least part of it's held by William Wing Loring's division. Loring, give him blizzards is his battle cry as he goes into action. Just a flowery guy to study. He's fascinating. He has fought in a bunch of different wars, the Seminole Wars, the Mexican-American War. He tried to fight in the Texas War of Independence. He goes off to Egypt after this. He's in the Mormon War. This is a guy who's seen a lot of action, lost his arm in Mexico, outranked Robert E. Lee before the American Civil War and was in charge of the United States Mounted Infantry, which is a really cool unit to study. But Loring is a controversial commander at times. But he's up here, and he is part of his men are holding this line. And if we're on the Confederate line, we're going to go from right to center to left. We'll have Stephen D. Leake, West Point class of 1854. He graduates with guys like Oliver Otis Howard, Jeb Stuart, John Bell Hood. He will be holding the right, Charleston native. In the center is Nashville, Tennessee native Benjamin Franklin Cheatham. Benjamin Franklin Cheatham's family actually helped to found Nashville here. And then we'll be inside of the lines of Alexander Peter, for Gary, Stewart's line. Stewart is a West Point graduate himself, spent a few years in the Army before going to the University of Nashville. So we have two commanders up here with Nashville ties. So we're in here behind his forces here. Union side, like I mentioned, over on the extreme Union left, along the Chattanooga and Nashville Railroad. I think I have that mixed Nashville and Chattanooga Railroad. We have James Steedman and his United States Colored Troops, a mixed unit that has been thrown together that is going to attack on the Confederate right. The idea is to tie down that Confederate right so they can't help out the Confederate left. Very similar to what Ambrose Burnside tries to do at Fredericksburg in December of 1862. Steedman's men are going to attack Peach Orchard Hill, and it is going to be a pretty bloody stand-up fight over there. Then we will start to move in Thomas Wood. You probably know Thomas Wood from Chickamauga and a lot of Western theater battles. He's in charge of 4th Corps. And then our 23rd Corps, 1853 graduate of West Point, John Schofield, New York native. He is going to back up Wood, as well as Andrew Jackson Smith, who has elements of 6th to 17th Corps Army of the Tennessee, I believe. He has a hodgepodge unit as well. We're throwing units together out here. And what we're going to do, if we're George Henry Thomas, we're going to swing like a door. Just like Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain, we're going to try to swing around the Confederate left and dislodge him from this position. So that's the high-level stuff. Let's talk about what Gary Adelman has in store for us. Gary, let's get into the action up here.
Okay, good. Thanks so much, Chris, and thanks for grabbing the camera from me, Chris Mikowski. So, like Chris said, we are at Redoubt Number 1, right? But I would like to treat this like somewhat differently. Like, let's imagine that this small curve we see here is the much larger curve in the Confederate line. In other words, imagine Redoubt 1 being right here. It looks like some Confederates are running in to man the fort there. So there's Redoubt 1. And then imagine Redoubt 2 a few steps over. Then imagine Redoubt 3 a little bit over here. And then detached from them and a little further away, imagine Redoubts number 4 and 5 when we come over here. Now, Chris, how well manned are some of these redoubts?
Well, in Redoubts number 1, 2, and 3, I've got about 100 men and a few pieces of artillery. Over here in 4 and 5, I haven't really outfitted those yet. So there's some guys, but not a lot of... much of anything, which is why I left my hat over there in 3, because I'm just not well outfitted over here. But because of these hills, I'm feeling pretty good. I've got a good position.
Huzzah! Oh! Huzzah! Huzzah! And here come the horsemen. You're talking about some cavalry, some Union cavalry of a brigade commander named Stewart, and they absolutely overrun Redoubt number five, and some Confederates are still laid out in Redoubt number 4. And here comes Coons's cavalry here, coming up, and some of the Confederates run that way, and others run back to Redoubt 3. There's a few more there. There are some more Union infantry over there. There are some cannons over there, just in time for John MacArthur to actually attack. Huzzah! Huzzah! And they begin to fall upon Redoubt 3. A guy named Sylvester Hill actually goes in, specifically ordered not to, and he goes straight into Redoubt 3 and chases them away. The Confederates are really losing hope here. Hill decides to press his luck while Kenner Girard is coming off in this direction with more Union troops. And just note at this point that we're talking about Confederate companies against Union brigades. Companies of 30, 40, 50 against Union brigades of 1,500. I don't like those odds. They wouldn't have liked those odds. And they have almost no hope. And Hill is pressing his luck up here. Sylvester Hill is coming up. He is shot in the forehead, but his men continue onward toward and capture Redoubt 2. Just as more Union soldiers, Girard's men, other men are coming in. And now there's one Confederate redoubt left. It's Redoubt 1 over here. And they get out of there. You know why? Because all of a sudden there are thousands of Union soldiers in their rear, and Thomas Wood is going to sandwich them out from the the front. The Confederates have no hope. They're caught in a pincher, and they are going to run away. The Confederates on the other side of the line will also start to fall back using some of the pikes we told you about. The Nolensville pike, the Granny White pike, and a few other ones. I'm sorry, the Granny Chris White pike. And the Southerners have lost on the 15th, and they have lost big. Instead of a nice 4, 5, 6 mile line, they're going to consolidate back to what they think might be a strong, and indeed on one side, impregnable position south of here with a mile, with an only 2.5 mile line. The Confederates have already lost big this day. They're going to try to hold out long enough maybe to get off the field or to exploit some sort of an advantage. And that will be the subject of our next video. So this is a very brief summary of what happens on the 15th. Just know this, the Union bring overwhelming power to this attack. They're not only outnumbering the Confederates 3-1 overall, they're outnumbering them 5, 10, 15-1, in some areas 50-1. In order to overwhelm them here. The Confederates have no hope over here. On the other side, they're a little bit stronger, a place called Granbury's Lunette, where you have United States color troops, Steedman's guys, going in, jumping into a railroad cut after caught into a crossfire, breaking limbs and whatnot. It's a sad story as the USCTs are actually repulsed, but ultimately, they'd have the last laugh as the Southerners fall back that evening, live on to fight one more day, December 16th, 1865. Anyone else have anything to add here? Here comes Chris.
Well, first of all, I was promised I would get to be do some rebel yelling when I was running away. Instead, I get the Monty Python, run away, run away, run away. But I just want to underscore what Gary had to say. There are some really cool little gems of pockets of things to see here in Nashville. And if you take the time to connect the dots, you can get a really good big picture.
Good, good. And both Chris's had never been here before, so that's pretty cool. Not much to see, but I hope enough to help you understand a little bit about what happened here. You can see we're below a military crest, and you can come here and act out this a little bit better. If you have 50 people, it works better than if you have three. So thank you so much for coming on our short trip on December 15th, 1864. Thanks to Chris White behind the camera, who's doing all sorts of assets and putting them up. Thanks to Chris Makowski for willingly running away more than once from one readout to another. And thank you all for watching and joining us on our Western Theater swing. Get inspired at battlefields.org.